Hola a mis queridos hermanos de la iglesia Long Lane.
Willkommen in unserer Kirche.
Ciao e benvenuto alla chiesa di Long Lane. Ti mando un abbraccio forte e spero che tutti stiate bene. Ciao.
Buenos dias.
我的朋友，你们好， 光明。
Carajo, in un medium pemorini. Odavo.
Olá a todos, bem-vindos à igreja.
Madayaw, mga kaigsuunan. Akong dakong kalipay na makit-an mong tanan.
Sabayilek, swagadum. Inna ningale, kanan karinyadil walare, santoshamon.
Buenos días, hermanos. Qué lindo de verlos.
Well, good morning. Great to see you at the lane today. You're very welcome if you're tuning in for the first time or if you've been tuning in since, when was it? End of March we've been doing this since? Incredible. You're very welcome. You know, we've been through some turmoil, haven't we, as a nation, as a world. And we're continuing this morning with our series in Revelation, which really does get to grips with some of that turmoil. And later on this morning, Lisa is going to be unpacking what Jesus says to the church at Laodicea. And I have the privilege of already seeing it. It's spot on, so you'll be, you know, you're going to love that this morning. And we've also got lots of other things happening. We're going to pray for Peru. Well, that rhymes, doesn't it? Pray for Peru. We're going to hear a story of glory from Arthur. But before any of that, we're going to worship. So let's pray, shall we? I know it's weird sitting in your front room or, you know, watching this on the train or whatever, wherever you are, but let's worship. This is about giving worth to our great God. It's not about your circumstances. It's about He who's above all circumstances. So let's pray together. Lord, thank you that we can, that we have this incredible technology. Thank you that you go before us. And I pray today, Lord, as we sing together, wherever we are, Lord, that we would be joining with the angel choirs, worshipping you, the Holy One of Israel. In your mighty name, amen.
Okay. Hey! There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence. I've tasted and seen all the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and the shame is undone, in your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence. I've tasted and seen all the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and the shame is all. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us
you worship team, inspiring as ever. But we're going to hear from Sharon now. We've already heard from Sharon. Actually, she did a little greeting, didn't she, in Spanish earlier. I'm loving those. If you've got a bit of a foreign language, you know, you don't have to be proficient, just enough to say hello and welcome to church. you know, record it for me, send it to me. Brilliant. Anyway, Sharon is now going to tell us a little bit about what's going on in Peru and also with her ministry. And then we will pray for her at the end of that.
Hello, I'm Sharon, one of the mission partners of the church, and thank you for this time. I'm going to share a couple of things with you, information about what's going on in Peru and with the ministry and with me, and then also some things that you can be praying for. So thank you very much in advance for your prayers. So let's start off with Peru. What's happening in Peru at the moment? With coronavirus, Peru currently has the highest mortality rate in the world, but cases are beginning to fall. They've had a long time where they've just been high, and so it's bringing a little bit of hope. Some restrictions have been eased, so please pray that the cases will keep falling and that Peru will be able to begin its recovery. If you can imagine some of the restrictions they still have, children under the age of 12 are only allowed out of their houses for 30 minutes a day, and they can only go within 500 metres of their home accompanied by an adult from their household. So if we think we've got it bad here, imagine that scenario, parents. Crazy. So please pray for the kids and their families and all the repercussions of so much time inside. The next thing I'd like us to pray for is CLC Peru, Christian Literature Centre, which is the organisation sort of that I'm seconded to now. And they are, I'm still with Buena Tierra, but we're part of CLC. We're really, really grateful that we've just been able to get an import of Bibles and Christian books. And so just please pray that these Bibles can get in the hands of people who need them, that they would read them and that they would meet God through them and know him more. And just please pray for the staff as well. They have been super busy, super intense. There's less of them doing the same amount of work. So please give them a little bit of space in your prayers. Thank you. So, Buena Tierra, what's going on? I'm really grateful to God because we were able to do 3 training sessions during Bible Month in September online. We had really good participation from people all over Latin America, from the States, Venezuela, Central America, all the way down to Chile. So it's really exciting to be able to reach so many people. But I'm not really sure what we're going to be doing next, what Buena Tierra is going to be looking like, whether we should be looking at trying to print books or not. So there's lots of things to think about. So please pray for our next steps. And finally, those of you who have seen my newsletter and read my newsletter will have maybe seen this news. It might not be a surprise to some of you, but to others it might be like, "Oh, that's new." I'd just like to say that I am in a relationship with Moises, who I work with. We have actually been together for just over 9 months now. But as you know, I've been stuck here in the UK for more than 6, and we've actually only been in the same city for 6 weeks of our relationship. So please, please pray for us that we can grow together while we are so far apart. That would be awesome. So thank you so much for your prayers. God bless.
Oh, thanks for that, Sharon. Well, let's pray for Sharon, shall we? For the ministry, but also for her life. And let's pray for Moises, that they're suddenly, well, not so suddenly, but they've become in a long-distance relationship, haven't they, that was never meant to be like that. So let's pray for those guys. Lord, we thank you for Sharon. Lord, thank you for all that you put on her life, Lord, for you, for the gospel, for the hope that she's found in Jesus. Lord, I pray that you go before her in these days, Lord, as hopefully borders open and she can get back to Lima. And Lord, we pray for her in a personal life, pray for her and Moises, that you'd be with them, Lord, that you bless them, and that your hand would be on them in the days to come. And Lord, we thank you for it, and I pray today that you would do her good, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to hear from Arthur Robinson in a second. Before the local lockdowns kicked in on Merseyside, I was able to interview Arthur. So we're going to just have a little listen to Arthur's story, Arthur's testimony we sometimes call it, and it's a really cool one. And then after Arthur, Helen Dublin is going to bring the reading. And after Helen, Lisa is going to bring the word. So Arthur, good to see you. Could you tell us a little bit about yourself? Maybe, you know, things like where you were born and, you know, a bit about your life. That kind of thing.
Gillingham, Kent was where I was born, and I went to the local grammar school and had no particular ideas of what I wanted to do with my life. But doing national service in 1955, quite out of the blue, I found myself in a relay meeting from the Billy Graham Crusades in Kelvin Hall, Glasgow. And I was in favour of Christianity, so when they gave the appeal, I'd never come across anything like it. But after a great big struggle inside, I went forward. And in God's goodness, I found myself being counselled by a man who I'm fairly sure must have been a Plymouth Brethren elder. And he tried this way. I mean, all I could say initially was, well, I went forward to, I probably didn't say these words, but to give my vote in favour of Christianity, to encourage others. But he wasn't satisfied. He tested me, he questioned me. And the question that got me going was when he said, but has God forgiven your sin? Are you ready for the last judgment? Oh no, I said, but I hope one day I'll be good enough. Saying you where to go. And I'm fairly sure it was Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, not by works, but by faith. Oh, that's too easy, I said. But after a bit, it dawned on me, as he tried to explain this to my thick skull, I thought, actually, I've sort of heard this all before, because by then I'd read the whole New Testament through as a well-meaning church member. So he said, well, do you want to receive Christ now? Okay. So we knelt down on the floor and he said, you pray first. And all I can remember of my prayer was that it was, I said, oh God, I don't know what to say. Amen. But God heard. And from then on, arranged most amazingly for the right Christians to be in the right place to follow up. When I went back from national service to my sort of service job, who should I be found opposite but another Brethren elder? We had lunch together every day for the next 2 years and talked solid Bible, Christianity and church. Wow. Then I left and was called into the ministry. But I'd better stop at that point.
And that's intriguing. So you obviously were followed by the Brethren, which is funny.
Yes.
But so tell us a bit about your call from the civil service into the Lord's service. Oh, that's a title for a sermon.
Right. Well, I prayed each day about my work and gradually wondered if perhaps God wanted me to be doing something different. And I asked the vicar of our church, and he said, train for the ministry, and I said, no fear. But as I inquired a bit more about it, it turned out that to train for the ministry, I would have to give up the idea of getting married for 5 years while I went through the training. By then, we weren't engaged, but Helen and I were going very steady. And I thought, if I say no to the challenge of training for the ministry, I will worry the rest of my life that I pulled out of it for personal reasons so I could get married. The only thing to do, therefore, is to, as it were, put my head in the lion's mouth. I'll go on their test, their selection conference, praying that if it's not God's will, that they will turn me down. And I can say, it wasn't me who chose it, it was them. So I went on the selection conference, and guess what? They accepted
me. You got selected.
And I was organised for going on training, doing a physics degree in Durham University to start with, all in an amazingly short space of time, and off I went. And in the end, the authorities decided that putting off getting married till when I was ordained, 5 years hence, that would be too many big changes at a time. So, yes, I could get married earlier.
Oh, praise the Lord, eh?
We did.
Brilliant. So, now I know you've had a couple of very interesting ministry places over your ministry life. Well, tell us about a couple of them, if you could.
Well, I suppose the most striking was being able to go to South America, to Chile, as a missionary. And we were there for 12 years. And during more or less all of it, I was engaged in training local leaders for church leadership. And I was part of, in the last 5 years, I was part of a team of other missionaries working on a new training system, which in the goodness of God, I mean, we wrote it all in Spanish just for the Spanish speakers. But in the end, it's been translated into lots of languages in use around the world. And some years ago, the very approximate figures were that something like 1.5 million people had gone through the course in different countries.
Wow.
That's... So that to me, from a human point of view, is the great privilege that I've had. Then we came back to England, and things were more ordinary. We were in the East End of London for 10 years, in Netherley for 10 years, in retirement then, and we came to Long Lane.
I have a feeling that there's nothing at all ordinary about the East End or Netherley, but we're probably out of time. But when we finally get back together, we can ask you those questions, Arthur, can't we? Yeah. About that. Have you got anything unusual about yourself that that's something I could can you tap dance? What's your hobbies, that kind of thing, you know?
Right. Hobbies, model railways, making things, painting. I suppose those two are the...
Yeah. And, creative.
And listening to jazz music as well, traditional jazz, very much enjoy.
Lovely. Could you just say goodbye for me to everybody?
Say goodbye to them?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, wave my hand. Hi. Goodbye.
Good morning, church. Today's reading is taken from Revelation 3, verses 14 to 22. To the church in Laodicea, to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so that you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so that you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Those whom I love I rebuke and discipline, so be earnest and repent. Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person, and they with me. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches.
Good morning. My name is Lisa. And this morning, we are looking at Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 to 22. And we are looking at the final of the seven letters that John wrote to the church in Revelation. The words of Jesus to these seven churches. We are 100 miles away from Ephesus, which was the first church to receive a letter. Ephesus, you remember, was accused by Jesus of losing its first love. And here in Laodicea, the seventh church, Jesus tells them that they literally make him sick. So quite harsh words to come to this church. But let me tell you a little bit about the background of Laodicea before we go into the detail. It was founded by Antiochus II and it was named after his wife Laodicea. It was famous in the region for its abundant wealth and riches. It was the financial centre of Asia, so it was famous for banking and commerce, and obviously very wealthy. It had a flourishing textile industry. It was famous for the manufacture of black wool because of the black sheep that grazed on the fields nearby. And this black wool was famous in the area, it was very beautiful and shiny, and this Laodicea was very famous for the textile that it made out of this wool. It also had a very good medical school, which produced a healing eye salve. Laodicea had very high impenetrable walls, so it was very self-sufficient and could withstand any attacks. And it was very self-reliant. Following an earthquake in AD 60, they refused Emperor Nero's offer of help for financial assistance, instead saying that they would rebuild the city out of their own resources. The church was also equally wealthy. Many of the grandest houses in the area were owned by Christians. We think that the church was most probably established during one of Paul's missionary journeys. And Paul writes in his letter to the Colossians that he intended that letter to be read by the church in Laodicea too. That letter to the Colossians warns of false teaching in the church and encourages the church to stay true to God's plan of salvation. So we can assume that this was something Paul wanted Laodicea to know as well. Now, as I've read this letter, three things stand out to me. Problems, prescription, and promise. So we're going to look at these three things this morning. Let's start by looking at their problems. Now, there are four main problems with Laodicea. The state of the church, their poor water supply, their lukewarm Christianity, and they couldn't see. Now, we'll go through each one of those, starting with problem one, the state of the church. The church had been warned by Paul to avoid false teaching in his letter to the Colossians, which, as we know, was also intended to be read by the church in Laodicea. And the church in Laodicea had begun to blend into the culture that it was part of. Jesus introduces himself at the beginning of this letter by saying, "These are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation." Now in that letter to the Colossians, Paul says, "Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything else was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth." Paul was affirming Jesus' divinity and standing against any heresies which the church may have believed at the time. And we know that he wasn't just speaking to Colossae, he was also speaking to Laodicea. Jesus also is affirming his divinity in these words. He said, he is the Amen. Now we use Amen at the end of our prayers. It basically means so be it. It is the final word. So Jesus is saying, I am the final word. He says he is the faithful and true witness. In John 1, verse 14, it says, "The word became flesh and made its dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." Jesus is truth. He is faithful. Jesus also said he is the ruler of God's creation. Jesus was there at the beginning of creation with the Father, and he will be there at the end. Jesus is saying he is the origin and the source of creation. Creation old, which is the world that we live in, and the stars and the moon and the galaxies, and also the new creation, which is to come. By introducing himself to the Laodicean church in this way, Jesus is affirming his divinity as God, and he's saying to them, "You can trust me, I'm God. I've always been here since the beginning of creation. I am faithful and true, and I will have the last word." He is smashing down any false teachings that the Laodiceans had allowed themselves to believe. But Jesus goes on. I know all the things that you do, that you are neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were one or the other, but since you are like lukewarm water, you are neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. Which leads us to problem two, the poor water supply. Now, the Laodiceans were very wealthy. They had everything that they needed to be self-sufficient, apart from one thing, a decent water supply. Now, Laodicea's water came in from an aqueduct. Water was pumped into the city through pipes, and by the time they reached the city, the pipes were overground. Nearby Colossae boasted refreshingly cold mountain spring water, and Hierapolis nearby had natural hot water springs. But by the time the water got to Laodicea, it was lukewarm, and it also had a high mineral content because of the pipes it was pumped through. So it was not nice to drink, and it would have made you sick if you had to drink it. So when Jesus tells them that they are like lukewarm water, and it made him want to vomit, they knew exactly what he was talking about. Which leads us to problem three. They were lukewarm. Now, this warning is not Jesus saying, either be on fire for me or don't believe in me. I'd rather either of those than you be lukewarm. This is much more serious. Jesus is talking, don't forget, to the church. He's talking to Christians. He's saying, you've become so bland, so tasteless, that I want to spit you out. I can't even stomach you. You make me sick. They're really harsh words. But think back to problem two, the water supply. The Laodiceans knew exactly what Jesus meant. The hot water springs in Hierapolis were used for healing, and the cold mountain springs in Colossae were refreshing to drink. But Laodicea's water was bland, tasteless, and useless. Think about when you make a nice hot cup of tea. How lovely it is to drink a nice hot cup of tea on a cold day. Or maybe some iced tea on a hot day, and how refreshing that is to drink. But then think about when you make a cup of tea and you sit down to watch the TV and you get talking and you forget about it and you pick it up and you take a drink and, oh, that's disgusting, you can't drink it. That's what Jesus was saying that they were like. Jesus was comparing them to their own water supply. Jesus was telling them, your faith is useless. It's not making a difference in either your life or anybody else's life, and it makes me sick. Jesus is saying that I've seen what you do, your works and your Christian faith. And rather than bringing healing or being refreshing, it's stale, it's stagnant, it's not making any difference to others, other than maybe to put them off altogether. Their wealth had caused them problems. They'd become just like the culture that they lived in. They were apathetic and indifferent. Their services were dull and lacking passion. They were going through the motions. They'd no desire for growth. Laodicea is probably one that is most like the church of the 20th century. The name Laodicea loosely means the rights of the people. Is that not the cry of our times? The rights of the people? Ironically, the church in Laodicea had stopped caring about all of that. Let's think about some of the other things that have gone on in 2020. Remarkably enough, there hasn't just been a coronavirus pandemic. There's been other things happening, namely some protests. We've had Black Lives Matter protests, protesting against the deaths of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor, primarily, amongst others. We've had anti-lockdown and anti-mask protests. We've had climate change protests, women's rights protests. People in Hong Kong were protesting against democracy. We've had anti-Trump protests. The world is protesting, and it's demanding people's rights. And as Christians, we need to do something about it. We need to take a stand. We need to decide where we stand on all of these issues, but we can't do nothing. If you remember last week, Nick taught us that faith is a verb, it's a doing word, it means action. What difference is your relationship with Jesus, your Christianity, your faith, what difference is it making in your life? What difference is it making in your giving, in your community, in your walk with God? God doesn't want us to be lukewarm. Don't just go through the motions. Don't be like everyone else. Don't just say you're a Christian. In Amos 5, verses 21 to 27, God says, I hate, I despise your religious festivals. Your assemblies are a stench to me. Even though you bring me burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. Though you bring choice fellowship offerings, I have no regard for them. Away with the noise of your songs, I will not listen to the music of your harps. But let justice roll like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream. What God wants for us isn't going through the motions. It's faith in action. It's justice. Caring for the poor. Standing up for the oppressed. Looking after the orphan and the widow. Defending the weak. And if we look at Micah 6 verse 8, it says, what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. God wants our faith to stand out. He wants us to act, to love, and to walk humbly, not to be passive and indifferent. Let's look at the fourth problem with this church. They couldn't see their problem. To this rich and wealthy church, Jesus says, you say, I'm rich, I've acquired wealth and I don't need a thing. But you don't realise. You are wretched, pitiful, poor, naked and blind. As if being lukewarm wasn't bad enough. But they didn't even recognise it. We need to be careful that we don't become lukewarm like the Laodiceans. We need to recognise it and put a stop to it before that happens. Here's a few different ways how being lukewarm could happen, what you could recognise in yourself. Maybe you could think that you've cooled off, that you think to yourself, you know, I used to have a more passionate love for God. My relationship with God used to be on fire and now I can take it or leave it. Or maybe you've compromised. You've become a little bit too much like the world around you. When you're with your friends, when you're at work, maybe you're playing golf or you're going shopping, you just become like everybody else. Your Christianity doesn't stand out. You've started making compromising choices. Or maybe it's like this, that you just don't care. You've stopped caring about people. You've stopped standing up for injustices in society. You'd rather scroll through social media than open your front door, walk out of it and stand up for something. Do something practical. Which leads us to the prescription. Jesus says to this church, I advise you to buy gold from me. Gold that has been purified by the fire. Then you will be rich. Also buy white garments from me, so you will not be shamed by your nakedness. And ointment for your eyes, so that you'll be able to see. I correct and discipline everyone I love, so be diligent and turn from your indifference. Jesus talks to them about the things that are important to them. Jesus urges them that rather than being wealthy in material things, that they look to him for real wealth. In Matthew 6 it says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. And as we live out our faith with Jesus, our faith will become like gold refined in the fire. In 1 Peter it says, These things have come so that proven genuineness of your faith, of faith great, worth greater than gold, which perishes even though refined by the fire, may result in praise, glory and honour when Jesus Christ is revealed. So Jesus is saying, come to me, buy your wealth from me, get the wealth that I've got to offer you. Not wealth that's going to rot and wither away and be destroyed, but real wealth, real gold that's going to grow and grow and grow, and as like gold refined by the fire. It'll be so much better than anything you could ever earn. Jesus says to wear garments of righteousness from him. In Isaiah 61, it says, I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of his righteousness. As a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and a bride adorns herself with jewels. God sees our shame and our nakedness. He knows where we've gone wrong. He knows when we've become lukewarm and when we've started to, our focus has waned away. He knows all the stuff that we don't tell other people about. And he offers us the righteousness of Christ. White robes of righteousness, which is in stark contrast to the black fabric that the church in Laodicea was offering. And we need his healing ointment on our eyes to remove our spiritual blindness. We need spiritual vision, an anointing of the Holy Spirit, which opens our eyes to see the truth of God and to understand his truth. In Ephesians 1:18, Paul writes, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, so that you will know what is the hope of his calling and what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Jesus tells them to let him meet their basic needs, to let him meet all the needs that they have tried to acquire by themselves. We already know that Jesus meets our basic needs. In Matthew 11, he says, come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. In John 7, Jesus says, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. And in John 6, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. No one who comes to me will ever go hungry. Jesus gives us rest. He gives us food and he gives us water to refresh our souls. When we surrender to Jesus to meet our basic needs, we can trust him to meet our deepest needs. Finally, we come to a promise. Jesus promises us in this letter that he only rebukes those he loves. And in Hebrews 12 we read, for the Lord disciplines those he loves. He punishes each one he accepts as his child. Now, God is a loving father. He gently corrects us and he shows us a better way, guiding us towards his truth, giving us a way out of our apathy and our indifference and our self-reliance. And finally, in verse 20, which often has been used out of context to evangelise to non-believers, Jesus says, look, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and we will share a meal together as friends. Those who are victorious will sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat with my Father on his throne. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. It's a great image to use with non-believers. But Jesus is talking to his church, to us. He is saying, I'm waiting on the outside of the door. You have left me on the outside of your churches, out of your daily walk, out of your relationships. And I want back in. I want to come back in and do life with you. I really want a relationship that leads to action and justice. Let's be friends. But you have to want it. You have to repent and let me back into your church, into your life. Stop being so self-sufficient, so focused, so pushing me to one side. Invite me back in. And if you do, you'll share in God's victory. Anyone who has ears, that's all of us. Let us hear. Let us listen to the Spirit. Stop doing things your own way. Stop fitting in with the culture around you. Stop leaving God out of your daily walk. Don't be lukewarm. Let your faith make a difference and let God meet your needs. Understand that God has spoken and it requires action. As Nick always says at the end of his preach, what is God saying to you and what are you going to do about it? We need to act this morning. We need to think about what God is saying and we need to move. We need to stop being lukewarm. Let us pray. Lord, we know that you are with us. We know that you are standing on the outside of that door and you want to come in. We pray that you'd forgive us where we've become lukewarm. We pray that you would forgive us where we've become so self-reliant and so self-sufficient that we feel like we don't need you anymore. We've made a pretense of Christianity and church and we've become so cold, so lukewarm even, Lord. We pray that you would forgive us. We pray that you would clothe us in your robes of righteousness. Lord, we pray that you would open our eyes to see the Holy Spirit and his power at work within us, Lord. We pray that we would come to you to meet our basic needs, to meet our daily needs, Lord. And we pray that we would be moved into action and moved into justice and help the community and the world around us. Lord, we thank you for your letter to the Laodiceans. Lord, we pray that you wouldn't, Lord, that you wouldn't look at us and feel sick. That you would look at us and see your amazing church, Lord, on fire for you, doing stuff for you, Jesus. We pray, Lord, all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Wow.
Well, thanks for being with us this morning. Thanks for worshipping. Thanks for being part of what God is doing here at the Lane. Don't forget, we've got live communion happening on a Sunday morning. So if you want to join in next week, just go to our website and go to the members area and sign in with the password. If you don't know the password, you need to email me. And if I like you enough, I'll tell you what it is. So there we go. Have a great week. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and give you peace. Give us a wave then.
By your grace, I'm blinded by your grace. I'm blinded by your grace. Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. I'm blinded by your grace. Came and saved me, Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fixed me. Now I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me.
One time for the Lord, and one time for the cause. And one round of applause, one time for Fraser T. Smith from the courts. I stay prayed up, then I get the job done. Yeah, I'm Abigail's youth, but I'm God's son. But I'm up now, look at what God's done. No, I'm real tall, look at what God did. On the main stage, running around topless. I phone flips, then I tell him that we got this. This is God's plan, they can never stop this. Like, wait right there, could you stop my verse? You saved this kid and I'm not your first. It's not by blood and it's not by birth. But oh my God, what a God I serve.
Lord, I've been broken. Hold on. Not worthy, you fix me. I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me, Lord. I've been broken.
I prayed I would find a way to another day. I was so afraid till you came and saved. You came and saved me. And the rain was pouring, 'cause the sun faded away. Now I'm in a better place, no longer afraid. Blinded by your grace, you came and this morning, I prayed I would find a way to another day. I was so afraid till you came and saved. You came and saved me. Yeah.
I'm broken, although I'm not worthy. You fix me. I'm blinded by your grace.
I'm blinded by your grace. I'm blinded by your grace, by your grace. I'm blinded by your grace. I'm blinded by your grace. Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me, Lord. I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. Now I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me.
One time for the Lord, one time for the cause. And one round of applause, one time for Fraser T. Smith from the courts. I think we got one. I stay prayed up, then I get the job done. Yeah, I'm Abigail's youth, but I'm God's son. But I'm up now, look at what God's done. No, I'm real tall, look at what God did. On the main stage.
running around topless. My phone flips, can I tell him that we got this? This is God's plan, they can never stop this. Like, wait right there, could you stop my verse? You saved this kid and I'm not your first. It's not by blood and it's not by birth, but oh my God, what a God I serve.
Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me. Lord, I've been broken.
I prayed that I would find a way to another day. I was so afraid till you came and saved. You came.